question is the desire to do, so we just want to do something. The interest or a drive, it's incentive or enticement, it arouses what?
If you're motivated to do something, then you actually are going to do something, which is great.
It's what stimulates us to act, something that arouses action or activity. Today, I want to talk about three things that are like the greatest motivators in life. And I don't care who you are, what you do, what you know, what you believe, what you don't, I think we'll agree with these three things. And we'll be able to apply it in our own personal life, no matter where you are in your walk with God. The first one is a no-brainer. That's a great one. Greatest motivator. Love. Second greatest one. Fear. The third one I'm going to be really spending a little bit of time on this morning is reward. Reward. Love, fear, and reward. Now, psychology today will tell you that there's a lot more, like self-actualization. I don't even know what that means. But they tell me it's a motivator. What else we got? Status. Power. Hunger. Hunger is a great motivator. When I'm hungry, I'm motivated too. So these are pretty basic. But in this expanded list of all these different types of motivations, these three are really the reasons that fuel our actions. These are what it kind of all boils down to that we'll be looking at. And besides, our source for truth can't be psychology today. I can learn something, find it very interesting. But First Peter tells us that we are given all things that pertain unto life and godliness, right? So grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of who? And who? Jesus. So you're supposed to, our grace and our peace is multiplied in our knowledge of God, in our knowledge of Jesus Christ, seeing that His divine power has given us how many things? Everything that pertains to living this spiritual life that we're living, and godliness. Godliness means being holy, you know, being a Christian, what it's like to live like you went to church today, you know, like being a Christian. So it says that God's given us everything we need. We're not lacking. We're not lacking at all. If we're not doing it, it's not because we weren't given it. So everything that pertains to life and godliness, and how do we get that everything? Through the knowledge of Him who has called us to His own glory and excellence. This is fascinating, the best thing to think about, because what He's telling you is that your excellence, your life, your godliness is going to be determined by your knowledge of God. Next, and that the more you know about God, and the more you know about Jesus, the more motivated you're going to be to live life and godliness. I mean, people who don't know God, they don't care. They don't care. It's the more you know it. Listen, because I've been a Christian a long time. By the grace of God, I care more about living for Him now than I ever have. And that's because I'm learning more about Him, where I have blinders on some things regarding my Lord Jesus. And I just, like, totally, it was like, the less I knew about Jesus, the less motivated I was to be like Him. So, knowing Him is really, really, really important. I'm glad you were church today. This is your only, this is just a kickstart, okay? What we're going to do here, I'm going to 37-minute teaching. It's not going to be enough for you. You may think it is, and, you know, it's going to go off, and there you go. It's not enough for you. Don't be that easy. Don't be that easily satisfied. And then don't wonder why my Christian life isn't what I read about in the Book of Acts, let's say. It's like those folks devoted themselves daily, like every day, to the ministry of the gospel, to hanging out with each other, to breaking bread from house to house. You know, it's a lifestyle. And I know that may not be what you want to hear today.
You might want to come someplace that says that you're okay just the way you are. No, we're not. God loves us too much to leave us the way we are, amen? And Jesus died so that we didn't stay the way we are, but that we can be to God's glory and His excellence. So it's pretty important that we know our Bibles. It's pretty important that we read our scriptures, that we spend time in fellowship and in prayer and in reading. No, I know, of course, I'm not a reader. I'm not a reader. I was a very bad student. But I hate it to read. How many people hate to read? I hate to read. I just don't like to read. So my mother would have to send away the, you know, the special companies that had special books for special children. So I was a special child and read special books because I really hated to read. Now, I'll tell you what, if you're like me, you're going to have to go to the Lord and say, God, I hate to read. You know what I mean? God, I'm afraid to serve. God, I hate people. Whatever it is. And ask Him to help you with that, because we need a knowledge of Him if we're going to live a life that looks like a glory to Him. Amen? So, you know, we got to keep that. The more we know about Him, the more we'll want to live for Him. So, anyway, the scripture tells us that we've been given everything to do. So I started thinking about this motivation thing in light of what the Bible says, because there's so many other sources that are going to help you to be motivated. And I'm like, you know what? How about the Bible? If everything's in there that I need to live this godliness life that I'm trying to live, it's got to be in there. So there are countless verses that capitalize these three topics of love, fear, and reward. Victor touched on sort of love tonight. Victor touched on one of the big three. The three things last week when he taught on knowing that God loves us. And that's truly profound. Does God love you? Does God love the person next to you? You better tell him. I don't think that that's right. I don't think that that's, you know, it's been made fun of. Jesus loves you, man. You know, it's like, yeah, he really did that. So if I was the devil, I would make all things profound, right? I would make them small. God loving you is not a small thing. It's the greatest thing. The greatest thing. All right, you know how great love is? God is it. Whoa. I thought about that when I was looking at this. I'm like, how great is love? God is love. He is love. How big is love? God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son that whoever believes in Him. Hey, I mean, that's just, no kidding. I mean, that's crazy. You want to talk about a motivator? What would ever motivate you to give your only son for a bunch of jerks like us? Amen? I mean, it's like, hallelujah, thank you, God, for love. And if God loves you, then that should be the only motivator. It really should. And I know it's not. It's just, because we're a fallen race in a fallen world, and we don't get that sometimes. That's not enough for us. You know, but by love, knowing that God loves us, can we face Goliath? Yeah. When we're challenged or disappointed or we're hurt, can we push through? Yeah, because of love. Because all that God has done to love us. And in first, y'all know this. The one who does not love does not know who. For God is love. By this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent His only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through Him. And this is love. Not that we love God. Remember those days when you didn't love God?
Yeah. God first loved us. He loved us and sent his Son to be the payment, propitiation for our sins. Verse 11. Beloved, if God so loved us, what should we be doing? Loving one another. You see the motivation factor there? It's like God is, he's working us. He's like, I love you, so if I know you, you need to be motivated to love others. So, here it is. God is setting up, make motivation. I love you, you should be motivated to love others. And I'm telling you, there is a correlation here. The more you recognize how much God loves you, so let me back up a little bit. Well, the more you recognize how much he shouldn't love you, when you think about what a jerk you really are, and I'm saying personal, I'm just saying, dead was dead, right? You know, when we were dead without God, without Christ in the world, when you remember that, and then you think how God loved you, that's crazy. You should be, like, in awe of things. And then that should be, oh, well, loving you is a no-brainer. People are tough. But God says he so loved us that we ought to love one another. So he's putting it out there as that great motivator. So do we all get that? We get that. And we get this. What happens when I don't care? What happens when I just, I really don't care? When I don't feel like doing what is right. Anybody ever there? You just don't want to do it what's right. You want to do what's wrong. What about when love is right? Then we have our next one. This is not a proper subject or a popular subject in churches today. It's called fear. Fear. Let's think about fear for a minute. Scripture says that the fear of the Lord is clean. That the fear of the Lord is enduring forever. This is pretty good. So is fear a real motivator? Absolutely. I'll tell you what. All advertisers really work this one. You can't turn on the TV and see an ad and not see an ad that is motivating you through fear. Now, it may be fear of, I don't know, not having the right clothes. It may be fear of, you know, getting this disease, so you have to take that. Or, you know, what else do you see in motivation of ads? Fear of what? Fear of missing out. What do you think? Yeah, you don't want to drop the phone. Not sitting in, you're afraid. What else can you be afraid of? That there really will be. Oh, yeah, don't you know that every drug is like, this person looks like a wonderful life because they take drugs. But if you take this one, you are going to die. Your hair is going to fall out. Your face is going to leave you. Your leg's going to fall off. You know, it's like, blah, 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 blah. So really, who would ever take it? It's like, not going to mind it. So, the world uses fear to get to manipulate, okay? God uses fear to motivate. And all of these things are in your best interest. They're not because God is this sadistic person who wants everybody to be afraid of in a bad sense. He knows that if you do not have the proper reverence and awe of an almighty God, you will never live the life that he wants to. Because love, it's very popular to teach on love and how much God loves you. You don't hear many teachings in the Christian church anymore about fear. It's just not vogue anymore. It was great during the Reformation. It was great in the 1800s. You might even have heard something in the 1900s, but now nobody talks about it because they're afraid that we're going to run people out. Let me tell you something. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. It's the beginning of knowledge. Fools, you don't want to be a fool. A fool despises that wisdom. A fool despises instruction.
But if you're afraid of the Lord, and I'm not talking like cowering and cannot approach Him, we approach Him. We should be cowering and can't approach Him. If it weren't for Jesus, that's exactly where we should be. We have boldness to enter into the throne of grace, not because we can stack up and stand up in front of a holy, awesome God. That's why I want to sing that song. Our God is an awesome God. Have we too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God? There are the times when, yeah, I know God loves me, but if I don't realize how awesome He is, that just doesn't mean much to me. How do I know that? Because I live like the devil. Because I make stupid choices. Because I don't care enough to do what's right. But good Lord, people, somebody remind me that our God is an awesome God. Somebody remind me, you know, when I'm just like being a total idiot, that God is an awesome God. We have to have that fear of the Lord, or we will not find the knowledge of Him that's going to help us to live all things that pertain to life and godliness. See how it all works together. You're not going to be motivated to study, to dive in, to really pursue God. You're going to be okay with mediocrity. You will marginalize the greatest being of all time. You will make Him insignificant. You will bring Him down to your level. You will make Him someone who does not have vengeance. Oh, God has vengeance. God repays. You have to have that as part of this whole picture of your relationship with God. It's not one or the other. They're not mutually exclusive. They're inseparable. Your love of God and your fear of the Lord. Does that make sense? It's a great spirit for that, really. Wait a second. Worship the Lord with love. And rejoice with. Isn't that cool? Rejoicing with trembling is not something you normally put together. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, and let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with what? Reverence and awe. For our God is, what is it? It's a consuming fire. What an amazing place. Without it, without remembering that, we can trivialize our God. Fear of the Lord is contagious. See, that was to say the love of God. It's just the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is something you just, when you have that fear of the Lord, you run away from evil. It's not enough just to love God and go, oh, I really love God. But He knows that. So if I do this evil, it's okay. No, this is the fear of the Lord, where you're like, okay, I'm listening for thunder because I know the lightning's coming. That's the fear of the Lord. When you know that you will not sin against me because of your respect and awe for what I fully God can do. That's just amazing stuff. That is very powerful. And then you start hating what God hates. Pride and arrogance and the evil way and the perverted mouth. God. Here's a verse I hate. One of the same verses I hate. Here's a verse. For if we go on sinning how? Willfully. Oh, aren't you glad you came to church today? It's a feel-good teaching. For if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for your sins. Wait, what? But a terrifying expectation of what? And the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries, our God. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And we may feel really good and happy, and that's all good. We got great joy and serving Him. But y'all know this ain't lasting forever, right? I'm just saying, Tim, I love what you shared. You know, there are no luggage racks on hearses, right? You know, at some point, boom, our chance is over. Either Jesus comes back, hallelujah, or you're going to get capped someday, right? Some of you sooner than others.
but we're all taking the dirt now. You know, nobody gets out of this thing alive without the return of Jesus Christ. We will all stand at the judgment seat of Christ. And God is both love and reverent. He's to be revered and to have an awe about that.
Not just ask with him, you know, whatever happens, happens. Really? Well, it's going to happen for a very long time. Whatever happens.
So, take it seriously. Take it seriously. So anyone who has set aside the law of Moses, he died without mercy. I'm testifying two or three witnesses. How much severe punishment do you think he would deserve, that we would deserve, who would trample underfoot the Son of God? And whoever has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified, what kind of punishment should there be for those of us if we insult the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is what? I will repay. And again, the Lord will do what? Judge his people. And it is a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God, folks. So, do we get this? Yeah? Okay. Can we move on from this? So, we have two motivators, the love of God and the fear of the Lord, right? The fear of the Lord. Now, I'm talking about this last one here. Rewards. Now, I touched on this a couple of weeks ago about the idea of being rewarded eternally by God. That, that's a weird subject because we all want to be like that spiritual person who goes, oh, I don't care. I don't care what I get. I just am so happy to serve God. Right? There are people out there, I'm sure, like that. I've never met them. Well, they may be like that for the first time that they go out and serve, but the 101st time that they get nothing in return kind of, can cause us to not want to give anymore, because of our false expectations that we expect people to do or to be so much more than they really are. And that is included within ourselves. So, did God make you? Did God make mankind? Does he know how he took? So does he know that when motivated by reward, did he make us that way?
Yes. Let's start there. That this was designed for me, not yours.
So when you feel like, well, I'm being unspiritual, when I'm excited about the rewards in the kingdom of God, when you think you're being proud, small-minded, you're not. You are part of the plan the way God made you to be. And this is something that we have to remember, because God does these things to inspire us so that we do what is best for us. And he's even came with that idea. Giving, loving, serving, all these things aren't just for the person that you're giving to. They're not just for God. Primarily, who benefits? You do. You do. Tell your neighbor, you're going to get the most out of this. They got to know it. It is in our best interest that we are motivated by eternal rewards. Jesus is the one who tells us this all the time. And he's the best, he's like this counselor. He's the best investment counselor. He knows that that's the best investment, is to do good work. The scriptures say that we are created. Are you saved by grace or works? You're saved by grace so that you can do what? Good works. You get it? God saves us by grace so that we can do good works. God saves us by grace so that we can do good works. It's not one or the other. Again, that's the point. God saves us by grace so that we can turn around and do good works. We are building an eternity. We're building on the foundation of Jesus Christ, but we all are building on that one. Look, I know this is a tough subject. It's not an American church subject. And I'm going to tell you why. How many of you are starving?
Anybody? Wait, this is some food. Get that woman some food. No, I mean, how many of you are going to die of starvation? How many of you do not, how many of you are in prison for the sake of the gospel? How many of you have their families killed and slaughtered because you chose Christianity? How many of you have lost your jobs and your ability to support your family because you chose Jesus instead of Muhammad? How many of you are in so much pain that you cannot leave your sick bed? How many of you don't have clothes to put on your children? This is an American church, folks. Ain't nobody in that kind of a situation that is sitting here right now today. And you know what? Because we are rich, although you may feel like, you know, I'm talking about that. We are so rich. We are so well fed. We are so self-actualized. We are so, we got it all, bitch, don't we? I mean, come on. We don't understand or appreciate what the kingdom of God is really going to be like. Because, frankly, we don't need it. We don't need it. The person who is imprisoned values freedom. The person who is so sick that they cannot move yearns for the new body that he'll receive in the kingdom of God. The person who has lost their entire family, whose children have been slaughtered, he lives for the day Jesus comes back and he sees them again. The person who has no money, I'm talking poverty, that person lives to be rich in Christ when he returns. The person who has been marginalized their entire life, who has no voice, that person is going to reign with Christ in the same city. That's a motivator, folks. Do you get it? Oh my gosh, we are too rich. We have too much. We don't put ourselves in a position that we need Jesus. We don't put ourselves out there. We don't put ourselves where we're afraid. It's all safe. It's American Christianity. We don't need the kingdom of God. We talk about it. Yeah, won't that be great when Jesus comes back? You know what you think about that? When you're having a bad day. Not when you're having a good day. We don't love the return of Christ like we need to. Folks, you may not be suffering, but there's somebody over there who is. You may not be hungry, but there are people dying of starvation. Make yourself poor somewhere, somehow. I don't know what to say. Does that make sense? How are you going to yearn and for Jesus coming back? How are you going to love his appearing if you don't realize how great it is and how really happy it is? Okay? We get talked into thinking that we're living with the enemy. No, the kingdom of God is the king. I think about those in prison. I think about, you know, the American, the African who was enslaved, who learned to sing, and the songs that they sang were about Jesus. Because all they knew was labor and punishment, persecution. And when they could sing, they had something to sing about. Because it was their only hope. It was their only hope. Folks, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know how you can become poor. But it's got to be somewhere in here. And losing a little bit of this could help too. You understand? Yeah, become broken. It's so easy to compromise. It's so easy to slack off. It's so easy to post
And then anything you started building as a Christian just starts to go into disrepair. Everything you started to be, it's so easy just to become okay, mediocre, satisfied, a beggar. I hope we have been saved. The hope. You hope that for what you see, what you already have is hope. But who hopes for what you already see? But if we hope for what we do not see, with perseverance, what will we do? We will wait for it. Do you understand? We need to develop a love of God, a fear of the Lord, and an excitement for the reward that will happen. I want to tell you just. You know Moses. Moses had it all, didn't he? Who was Moses? Was he a Hebrew? What happened to him? To the Ten Commandments. Who picked him up? Pharaoh's daughter. So how is Moses actually raised? King's son. King's son. Did the dude have it all? Did he have it all? Did he enjoy all the pleasures of Egypt? Absolutely. And the dude was like wealthy. He had the finest chariot, you know, all the girls, whatever. The guy was, you know, he had his king, Pharaoh's kid. Something happened. I mean, that dude, something happened. Because he said, I'm going to leave all that. I'm going to leave all that. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to serve God. Because I know there's a Messiah coming. And that changed something. He just snapped. Leaves Egypt, goes into the wilderness, gives up everything.
Left Egypt. He wasn't even afraid of the wrath of the king. He endured as seeing him who is what? Unseen. Folks. It says that he would rather endure a boatload of junk for Christ, for Messiah, than to live in the pleasures of sin. So we left Egypt. I think that's what we have to figure out. What's our Egypt? What is our Egypt that we need to leave? What is keeping us too comfortable? We have to ask ourselves and identify what we need to walk away from, what we need to make less important, what we need to minimize so that we can lead and serve God. Therefore, have other people done it before us? Yeah, and lots of people. We've got a great cloud of witnesses of people who said no. Know the self and rest of God, who were motivated by the love of God, who were motivated by the fear of God, who were motivated by the rewards of an eternal life with Him, more than they are interested in what they're going to get in this life. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance. You understand? You've got to identify what you're encumbered by. What's keeping you from serving God and going all in? The sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with what? The race that is set before us. So it's our turn. And the way we do it is the same way Jesus did it. We kind of definitely was motivated by a reward. Jesus was motivated by a reward. Do you agree with that? Fixing our eyes upon Him. The author and the perspective of our faith, He, who for the joy set before Him, see that? The joy that was set before Him, that was Jesus' hope. That was Jesus' reward. That was what Jesus was going to get if he would do what God asked him to do. He endured the cross. Folks, you don't have to endure a physical cross, but maybe there are some crosses that we need to pick up, that we need to bear, that we need to lay down some of our Egypt and ask the Lord to help you to figure that out so that you're free. And he sat down at the right hand of the Son of God. How's that for an eternal reward, amen? So, my closing verse here is, don't lose heart. Don't lose heart. Though your outer man is decaying, yet our inner man is being renewed how often?
for momentary light affliction, whatever you have to do, whatever you have to give, whatever you have to give up, whatever you have to change, is it going to be an affliction? Yeah, not going to be fun. But that momentary light affliction that you're dealing with is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. If we're looking at not what's seen, but what is what? Not seen. All the things that you're not seeing, but the things that you're seeing, how do they last very long? But the things that you're not seeing are what? You have trade-off. You have trade-off. Just ask the Lord to show you what it is that, what is it you need to let me. And it's not always physical. Sometimes it's mental. Sometimes it's emotional. Sometimes you got to give up complaining. You know what I mean? Sometimes you got to give up posturing. Sometimes you got to give up pride. Sometimes you got to give up our ego. Sometimes you got to give up our critical judgmentalism. Some of these are the things that we have to give up so that we God. So we're going to love God. We're going to have a fear of the Lord. And we are going to learn and appreciate and start yearning for the things of the kingdom of God to motivate us to love others and serve them. Lord, we're grateful that we have the opportunity to do that. And love you and serve you. And thank you so much for being with us and for teaching us, Lord. Work through all of us as individuals, please, God. Show us what it is that we need to let go. It could be huge, it could be small, it could be, I don't know, something. And motivate us, Lord, through the love that you have that sent Jesus to the cross. Motivate us through our fear of awesomeness. And that day of commendation and celebration that is coming. And you will reward us eternally for what you choose to do now in this life. And this life is short. We need to get in the younger. We need to